So this is the topic in which I will explain something about what is earthquake, because there are many misconceptions which are there as far as earthquake is concerned. And many of the, sorry to say, many of the civil engineers also are not aware of the many of the terms related to earthquake engineering. So my aim is to acquaint you about the knowledge of earthquake engineering, as well as the aspect of earthquake engineering, housing in the earthquake engineering, and new research areas in case of housing related to the seismic prone areas. If you heard about the disaster, you know, disaster, this is the definition given in the literature, that the disaster means the catastrophe, mishap, calamity from nature or man-made cause, or by accident or negligence, resulting into loss of life, damage to the property beyond the coping capacity of the community. So basically, what is the disaster? Disaster is the term in which, you know, the community cannot do anything. Your ministry, your government need to intervene in between the calamity, so that the community can be saved from the disaster. Each and every calamity that is not a disaster, because first the risk is there. Suppose a heavy rainfall is there, so you can say that rainfall is heavy. If you can manage it, you can manage your drainage system, that rainfall, though it is a very heavy rainfall, but you can cope up with the situation. Community itself can cope up with the situation because of that heavy rainfall. If your drainage system is good, if your in a case of earthquake, if some earthquake activity will be there in any of the region, if your structure is earthquake resistant and your structures are not collapsed. Suppose in case of Japan, many earthquakes are there, but few earthquakes, in very few earthquakes, the structure got collapsed and the loss of life will be there. So, but first the risk will be there, then the second term is hazard. Then risk lead to hazard. When these two terms, when we are not taking care of risk, then it leads to hazard. That hazard can be there, that the heavy rainfall or a earthquake or a cyclone can damage your structure, can damage your property. Then that risk lead to hazard. Then when the hazard will be there, when we are not taking care of the hazard, then that hazard lead to disaster. If you are, suppose your community is ready, if your community is equipped that what need to do in a flood situation, what need to do in an earthquake situation, your community is prepared, you know if tsunami will be there, then where we need to go. So the capacity building is already there with the community, and they know how to deal with the situation, how to deal with the natural calamity. So that is not lead to disaster. If we are not aware of that, what we need to do in case of fire, in case of flood, in case of earthquake, in case of cyclone, then that gap between the knowledge and that gap between the people, that they should know that what to do in the disaster, that lead to disaster. Because first the risk is there, then hazard is there, then that lead to disaster. Okay, so some of them agree with you, with me, that many of the activities, many of the developing activities in our country, so we are having very less land to construct our own houses, because of lot of population in our country, so we are going very haphazardly as far as our construction is concerned. Sometimes we used to construct the things in between the flood areas, in between the channel areas from where the water will go, or we are not constructing the earthquake resistant housing. So there are many aspects that leads to disaster. So there are different type of disaster, that is the natural disaster and man made disaster. Natural disaster, definitely earthquake, cyclone, flood and drought. And man made disaster, accident, violence, war, nuclear explosion, chemical reaction. And another thing, now man-made disaster can also be termed as, in case of when we are not making our house earthquake resistant, that also lead to disaster. If we are not taking care of a cyclone, if we are not giving the knowledge that what to do during the cyclone, so that also lead to disaster in case of flood also, in case of drought also. So now there are different aspects changing from this man-made disaster. So we need to take care of this man-made disaster, because natural calamity and these man-made disasters, now they are clubbed together. Natural calamity is there, but we are not prepared. That lead to that creates the problem for the community. So now I'll talk. My topic is earthquake and earthquake engineering. So I will talk more about the earthquake and how the earthquake is there, because many misconceptions is there. So many of you can termed the earthquake, that movement of earth crust can be termed as earthquake, right? But you know, during what is the cause of this movement of earthquake? Basically, the earthquake is a concept of energy. Lot of energy is generated during that earthquake, and because you know, you can say that earthquake can be generated due to the movement of tectonic plates. Also, earthquake can be generated from the your cyclone. From this volcanic eruptions. So you know, whenever any activity will be there below our earth surface, so lot of energy will be generated during that earthquake, and this energy is transferred. That energy is transmitted below our earth surface in the form of waves. So there are different waves which are formed because of this the generation of the energy. So the earthquake is a concept of energy that is generated during that earthquake. How much energy is generated? That the explosion of many atom bombs will be there, so that much energy is generated during that earthquake. Suppose the earthquake of magnitude 5 is there, and the earthquake of magnitude 6 is there. So from 5 to 6, the energy will be multiplied 30 times, means 30 multiplied by 30, around 1000 times energy is increased to 30 times. Another from 6 to 7, another multiply by 30 times. So 1000 multiplied by 30, 3000 times. So you can see that the multiplication of this generation of energy will be there during any of the earthquake activity. And in many of the cases, you will feel during the earthquake that your earth is moving. And that is how we know the earthquake is there. So in case of the earthquake engineering, there are many terms which are concerned with this the earthquake. One is hypocenter, epicenter, and when we used to call it magnitude of the earthquake, intensity of the earthquake. So there are many terms related to that that earthquake is there. The hypocenter is the point from where the energy is generated below the earth surface. You know, the hypocenter from where your tectonic plates see, below our earth surface, our tectonic plates are moving continuously. Some of the tectonic plates, they are moving away from each other. Some of the tectonic plates, they are passing each other. Some of the tectonic plates, they are moving towards each other. So continuously our earth surface is in motion. Okay, our tectonic plates is in motion. So suppose your tectonic plates are moving away from each other. So from where, weak point will be there, where the stress increases, and that stress increases beyond the threshold limit. So it breaks from there, and that is the point. That point is called as hypocenter of that earthquake. And just above that surface, the surface on the earth surface, that is called as epicenter. Just vertically above that hypocenter, that point is called as epicenter of the earthquake. And the earthquake which we are more concerned about, the earthquakes are happening below our earth crust, many kilometers below our earth crust. Suppose even 700 kilometers also, some movement of the tectonic plates are there. But we are concerned about the shallow depth earthquakes, the earthquakes which occurs at the shallow depth, just at above the depth of 70 kilometers, because they are more destructive, because the waves will move just close to our earth surface, just close to our buildings. So the waves will move into our buildings. So we are concerned about those earthquakes which are of shallow depths. So, how many types of earthquakes are there? So we there are this technology, this terminology. The suppose earthquake, we used to say that magnitude of the earthquake. What is the magnitude of the earthquake? Magnitude of the earthquake is the energy released during that earthquake. That is called as magnitude of the earthquake. Suppose earthquake happens in Kanpur, for example. So magnitude 5 earthquake is there in case of Kanpur. So it is known everywhere that earthquake of magnitude 5 is there in Kanpur and at this time, right? So in case of that magnitude is we can calculate with the help of this Richter scale. This is the Richter scale. We can calculate the earthquake by using this Richter scale. I will definitely tell you that how you can, we used to call it this, if this hapsidal lines, we used to call it as signature of that earthquake. So how this signature of the earthquake can be read, I will definitely explain you in the coming slides. So this is the Richter scale, and magnitude is the energy released during that earthquake. And another term is intensity of that earthquake. Intensity of the earthquake means the damage occur at a particular location. So it depends upon location to location. Intensity of the earthquake differs from place to place, because it is the scale by which we use to measure the damage occur at a particular place. Suppose the place is very near to epicenter, so damage will be there, so intensity will be high at that place. And when we move away from that place, when we move away from the epicenter, intensity goes on reducing. Suppose earthquake came in any part of the world, so we are hardly heard, we are hardly have some of the some damage in our country. So when the earthquake will happen, suppose Bhuj earthquake, the earthquake happened in Bhuj, and the damage in the adjoining areas are more. So in case of Nepal earthquake also, when the Nepal earthquake was there, so some of the damage, that very small damage, also happened in case of your UP state. So the intensity of the earthquake in case in UP is very less. In case of Nepal, it is very high. So depend upon damage of that earthquake. So in case of magnitude, if the magnitude is up to 4.9 on the Richter scale, we used to call it as slight earthquake. If that magnitude is from 5 to 6.9 magnitude, that is moderate earthquake. 7 to 7.9, it is great earthquake. And 8 or more magnitude, it is very great earthquake. So we need to, this is the terms given in Indian standard codes, that how we classify the earthquakes. So this is the scale we used to calculate the intensity. We used to find out the intensity of the earthquake as per the modified Mercalli scale. So this is the scale divided into from 1 to 12th of the Roman number. And 1, when you feel that like that some earthquake is there, in intensity 2, when it is very, you can see that objects are moving, your fan is moving, and some other objects are moving in the room. So intensity 2, intensity 3, you are if you are sleeping, that you will wake up because of that movement of earth. Some in some of the cases, it is very difficult to stand. Some non-engineered structures collapsed. Okay, some ground failure will be there. Some engineered structures also, some engineered structures also collapsed. So this is how the intensity is divided into 12 parts. So the depends upon the damage of the structures. So this is the zonation, micro zonation, seismic zonation map of the country. You can see that country is divided into 4 zones: zone 2, zone 3, zone 4, and zone 5. Earlier, zone 1 was also there. So this is the map, seismic zonation map of the country. And this red portion is zone 5, green portion is zone 4, yellow is zone 3, and blue is zone 2. But it doesn't mean that if you are residing in zone 2 or zone 3, zone 5 earthquake cannot be there. So that is not there, because this seismic zonation map has been changed from time to time, and depend upon the past earthquakes, depend upon the situation of the tectonic plates. Researchers, seismologists, so they made this map. And they made this map because if you are doing something, if you are making your buildings, if you are making your industry, if you are making any of the activity in particular zone of the country. So you can take care of, suppose you are making the structure in zone 3. So you need to take care of zone 3 of the earthquake, but you can take care of zone 4 or zone 5 of the earthquake. That depend upon the you, because whenever we used to construct earthquake resistant house, any construction earthquake resistant, so cost of the construction used to increase from 5 to 10%, because you need to provide many bands, you need to provide many reinforcement in the structure. So slight increase in the cost will be there. So in case of this seismic zonation map and earthquake is concerned. So now there are different type of seismic waves which used to be generated because of this energy, because of the large energy which is produced due to any seismic activity. When the energy is travel below your earth surface, that energy travels below your earth surface in the form of waves. So first, primary waves will be there. That is very fast wave, and they are compressive in nature. You know, primary waves are compressive in nature and they are very fast. Now, then again, the secondary waves will be there, or you can call it as shear waves. They are, these waves will travel your earth surface, and energy is transmitted to your buildings. Because of these waves, your building will move in a different direction. Suppose in P waves, your building will move, you know, front and backward, like you are traveling in a bus. Okay, you are traveling in a bus, and suddenly bus will stop. Then how you will fall? You will fall against the movement of your acceleration. Suppose you are moving in the front direction, if the brake will be there, then you will you will move in the opposite direction. So like that, this primary waves will move your building forward and backward. So in case of secondary structure, that is shear waves will move your structure up and down. So more shear force will be generated in your building, more compressive force will be generated in your building. So this some surface waves are there, Rayleigh waves and Love waves. So these are the movement of your waves. Suppose primary waves will be there. So like compressive nature, you can see here in the spring, that is compressive in nature. And in case of S waves, if you'll wave this rope, if you'll tie this rope from one end and you will wave this rope, how the rope will move. So likewise the wave will be move in below your earth surface, right? This is the love waves like snake will move below your earth surface, and this will give twisting moment to the structure. This will give to a twisting moment to the structure. This is love waves like flow of sea will be there. Like this, the waves will be propagated below your earth surface. So this is how the waves will be generated. Because of these waves, your structure, there are two type of structure, like load bearing type of a structure or your framed structure. So in both the kind of a structure, these component of these buildings will experience the out of plane action of the force and in plane action of the force. So suppose your building will be there, this is your building, and if the force will applied in this direction, right, if the force will be applied in this direction, so this is the in plane action of the force, because then during the earthquake, inertia force will be generated, and this inertia force will be applied in this direction. So this is the in plane action of the building. Your building will be moved like this. And if the force will be applied in this direction, so this will be the out of plane action of the force. So your building will be overturned. Your building can be overturned. So this is the two forces which are of main concern for any of the engineers: in plane action of the force and out of plane action of the force. There are two type of forces. In case of load bearing type of a structure, load is bearing by the walls only, right? In case of frame structure, load is bearing by this column and this beam, right? And here we used to have infill walls in our country. We used to have infill walls.
So we used to have this infill walls, and these infill walls, which we are making of brick, this is the rigid kind of a structure. You know, when your building is moving, when your frame is moving, but this wall will not move. This wall will have the tensile. If this will have the pressure at the joints of your beam column joints, right? These joints will fail. So we need to take care of in any of the earthquake. If you will read some of the papers, so you can find out that many of the papers will be of infill walls. Many of the research will be there in case of infill walls, and in case of load bearing type of a structure, we need to take care of that we are not allowing our structure to move beyond a certain limit. So this is how the earthquake resistant design we used to do. In case of this location and measurement of the earthquake, so this is how we can determine the location of the earthquake, size of the earthquake, what is the effect of this earthquake in our country. So this is the first kind of seismograph. This is a seismograph which have been developed, which have been invented in 132 AD by the Chinese astronomer Cheng Heng. So seismograph, you can see there are 8 dragons and some frogs are there with the open mouth, and the one brass bowl is there in the mouth of these dragons. So whenever any of the seismic activity, any of the earthquake activity will be there, this brass ball will fall into the mouth of this frog and some sound will be there. So this is the kind of very initial stage this kind of a seismograph have been developed. But nowadays we are having digital seismometer, and we can have the digital seismograph, and we can have the movement in we are having triaxial accelerometers. We can have the acceleration in case of x direction, y direction, z direction, and these all are digital accelerometer, and we can have the signature of the earthquake in any of the direction. And those accelerometers are very sensitive. They can measure any of the activity below the earth surface. Okay, right. So this is the this is how we can locate the epicenter and the magnitude of that earthquake. Suppose first I have already told you that P waves will be there, then S wave will be there, then L waves, then R waves. Okay, so there are different kind of waves. So here you can see in case of this P waves, these are the P waves that is compressive in nature, and S waves here, these are the S waves, and you can see that the amplitude of the S waves are more as compared to P waves. So you can make different you can have the difference of this P waves and S waves, how these moves, how we can have the amplitude of these waves during the earthquake. So we can know the average speed of that that earthquake, and we need to have some one very very well scaled graph, well scaled world map, and we need to have one chop, and we can find out the epicenter and magnitude of the earthquake. How we can find out the magnitude of the earthquake? Here you can see that in the previous slide, you can see that here, suppose P wave started at 0 seconds, just earthquake started, and P wave started at 0 second, and S waves after P waves after 24 seconds, after 24 second S waves are there. So first we used to find out that the P waves and S waves, the time difference between P waves and S waves is 24 seconds, right? So here you can see that the P waves and S waves difference is 24 seconds. So here it is written S and P waves on the Richter scale, and distance is around 215 kilometers, right? Here we can find out the distance is 215 kilometers from the center. So for finding out the epicenter, we need to have the three centers. Suppose we are having the world map of having 100 kilometers equal to 1 centimeter, right? So 100 kilometers equal to 1 centimeter means if we are having the distance of 215 kilometers, so just open the your compass for 2.15 centimeters and draw one circle from point A, and suppose from point B some distance came, maybe 100 kilometers, maybe more than that, so you just draw another circle, then third circle, where these three circles will meet, that will be the epicenter of that earthquake. So this is the manual calculation, but now we are having digital calculator. So we used to find out the epicenter very quickly, but we need to now, this is the three station which we need to have to locate the epicenter. But in case of digitally, we used to have many centers and then we used to locate the accurate epicenter. This is the procedure, right? P waves, suppose P wave started as at 0 seconds, right? For 24 seconds, that S wave started, right? This is the Richter scale. This is the Richter logarithmic table. It is given. Now here it is written here S and P in second, right? And here it is written distance in kilometer. Then S and P 24 seconds. Then kilometer 215 kilometers. Right, from a particular situation. So how this is how we can find out the distance from one point, right? Now, but here if we can you can see this signature of the earthquake, then we need to find out the amplitude of this signature. Then here the amplitude is 23 mm, means from the baseline how much height it attained. So this is 23 centimeters. So here it is written amplitude in millimeter, right? Here 23 second. When you will join this point and this point with a straight line, you can have the magnitude of the earthquake, which is written in the middle portion of this Richter scale. How this Richter scale, you can read this Richter scale. This is the procedure by which we can find out epicenter and magnitude of that earthquake, right? This is clear. These are some of the Indian standard codes by which we use to design our buildings. There are the codes for low strength masonry buildings. There are the codes for seismic strengthening of the structures. There are the code for ductile detailing, earthquake resistant construction. Okay, so there are many codes available by which engineer use to design their structures in case of seismic areas, right? So these are the things that what we should do before, during and after the earthquake, because this is a very important thing, that how you will act before the earthquake, during the earthquake and after the earthquake. This is the key point, because you can manage the risk, you can manage the hazard. So by how you can manage the hazard and risk, by knowing that what you should do during any of the climatic activity, because this is very important. So what you need to do before that earthquake. Okay, first, you need to make sure that you need to have fire extinguisher at your home place, at your car, because whenever we used to buy a new car, right? We used to buy some pillows, which we used to keep it at the backside. That pillow cost around 450 rupees or 500 rupees. But, fire extinguisher cost only 150 rupees, right? So fire extinguisher, we are not keeping this fire extinguisher with our, with our cars, with our houses. So this is a great problem during any of the earthquake. So we need to have fire extinguisher in our house. And another thing, we need to learn first aid. So this is very important to learn the first aid, because many of the persons can be hurt during any of the climatic activity. During earthquake, it is very important. Suppose you are not having first aid kit, you are not having the kit in your house, so that also matters. Now, another thing, you need to learn about how to turn off the gas, water and electricity during any of the activity, because this is very important to acquaint the switch off point to your to the people of which are residing in the house, that how to switch on the gas, water as well as electricity. And another very important thing, make a plan for your family that where they will meet after the any of the natural calamity, because during any of the calamity, during any of the disaster, your communication system will be gone, your roads will be not be there in place, any of the communication equipment you cannot run, you cannot operate any of the communication equipment in your mobile phone. If the battery will be discharged, your towers will be damaged, so you cannot contact with your beloved persons during any of the disasters. So you need to take care of, you need to make the plan in your house that during any of the activity where you will meet after the disaster, right? So this is the very important thing. Anything can happen at any time. You cannot plan, but this is the planning you can do before the earthquake. And another very important problem which we are having in our house, when we used to get married, okay, so we are having our marriage photographs, and that marriage photograph we used to keep on the head side of our bed where we used to sleep, right? If you will keep that photograph on your head during any of the activity, any of the earthquake, if that photograph will fall on your face, so you can well imagine that how much damage it can be there if that photograph will fall on you. So my main point is there that don't keep heavy object. Okay, don't keep any of the heavy object onto your just near to your head or just where you are sleeping. Just you keep the heavy object in the cupboard, and you can close that cupboard. So don't keep it there. So what another thing? Anchor your furniture. This is another thing is that if you are in any of the polytechnic, any of the engineering college, any of the school, so you are kindly requested to acquaint your school children, to acquaint your polytechnic children, or acquaint your engineering students that how you will act during that earthquake. This is the plan how you can evacuate from this building. Evacuation plan of your building should be placed each and every place, that how you can evacuate from the building during any of the seismic activities. But because I have seen in many of the buildings, in case of our institute also, we are not having the evacuation plan during any of the activity from where you will move out of this building, right? That evacuation plan should be there during that earthquake. First of the thing during that earthquake, that you need to keep calm. Don't rush, because you know, if you will rush, if you will create any of the rushing situation, any of the situation by which your mind will not work. So keep calm. Just if earthquake is there, if you are sitting near to any desk, just hide yourself under that desk and hold that desk tightly, right? So this is the main key, that don't rush, don't move out of the building, because outside also buildings are falling, right? So if you are sleeping on the pillow, that keep this pillow on your head, then run away, because you know your head is a very sensitive part. If any of the damage will occur to your head, so it will lead to any of the death of any of the person. So keep that pillow on your head, then only run out of your building. Don't use any staircase, okay? And if you cannot move out of your building, just move and stand below the doors opening, just door opening, because that door openings, they are having frame of the door, they are having beam of that above that door frame. So that is the safest place. Don't move to the corner of the building, because corner can fall any times. The corner of the buildings are the vulnerable place where you should not stand. Don't stand near the tree, because tree can also fall, right? Don't stand near any of the mirror or any of the things which can be shattered, right? So these are the things which you need to do during that earthquake. Don't use matchsticks, candles, flames, or you cannot broken glass lines, fire. Don't do anything. Just stay in your where you are, stay like that only. Okay, so if you are in the car, stop the car, stay in the car until the earthquake will stop, because this car will be a cushion for you. If anything will fall, you will be safe in the car. Just be in the car. Don't use elevators. what you need to do after that earthquake, after the earthquake is over, just check yourself. If you are not hurted, if you are not injured, check your neighbors also, because they may need your help. Check you as well as check your neighbor also. Check whether any of the leakage of the gas is there or not. Check the damage in your buildings. Check the walls. Smell. If some smell of the gas is there, just open the windows quickly. Don't switch on the light. Don't use any matchstick. Don't use any of the equipment. Don't use your mobile phone. Right? Turn on your radio, because radio is the only gadget during any of the disaster. The radio will work 24 hours because that works on the batteries. But we nowadays, in the earlier era, we used to have radio in our homes. But nowadays, because of these mobile phones, we are having radio in our mobile phones. So we are not keeping radios in our home, but we need to keep radio in our home, because our mobile phone can be discharged, but our radios can work for 24 hours, right? So have radio in your home. Stay out of the damaged building. Don't go inside the cracked building, because you know, in some of the cases, many NDRF team, they shared their experiences that when the building is cracked, so some of the people they rushed into the building to take their belongings, to take their valuables, but that buildings can be fall anytime. Don't go inside the building, right? Be careful from the broken glasses, debris, and always wear boots pehniye. Then if you are residing in any of the coastal areas, so be careful during any of the seismic activity. Tsunami can be there, because before 2004 we are not aware of tsunami, but after 2004 we are the world best country to have the early warning system for tsunami. We are the world best country. We are having world best equipments to have the early warning system of tsunami because of the 2004 activity. Tsunami can be there. So stay away from the damaged area. And if you are having the evacuation plan of your building, if you are having emergency plan of your schools, your polytechnics, your engineering college, follow that plan. Follow that plan, because in any of the, suppose tsunami is there, you need to have the evacuation plan from where you will go to the elevated places, because during tsunami nothing can work, only you can run. A very good swimmer also cannot swim during tsunamis, right? So the speed of the water is more than that of the speed of the jet plane, right? So that much speed of the water is there, and the wave can be generated up to 100 feet, right? So this is the thing. And always expect aftershocks. In case of Nepal, we used to always remember the Nepal earthquake, because after the earthquake, main earthquake activities, we were having around more than 90 aftershocks, which are of magnitude more than 6, right? So means aftershocks are also very considerable. And another thing, in case of Nepal earthquake is a long period earthquake, right? Long period earthquake means the earthquake activity happened, because earthquake is of very short duration, around 20 seconds, 20 to 25 seconds, 30 seconds. But that Nepal earthquakes are long period earthquakes. It happened more than 30 seconds, right? 45 seconds, like that. So those earthquakes are long period earthquake. So that's why the single story and the two story buildings are also damaged quite extensively, right? So these are the question which you will always ask, that can we predict earthquakes? Can we are having any of the technology that we can know that when the earthquake will be there? So here I would like to tell you that till date we are not having any of the foolproof technology by which we can predict earthquake very precisely. But researchers are working in this field, and one of my friend in IIT Roorkee worked on it, Dr. A.K. Mathur, professor, at the department of IIT Roorkee. He is working on the early warning system for this earthquake is concerned, and he has developed one of the technology by which you can have the warning of the earthquake, but the time of the warning is only 1 minute, 60 seconds, also depend upon the distance of the epicenter, right? So they are doing some of the research. In other countries also, many of the researchers, they are working on this early warning system, but till date we are not having any of the precise this early warning system as far as this earthquake is concerned, right? So these are the effects of the earthquake, that tsunami will be there, building collapse, fire, ground failure. So these are the some of the photographs of the ground failure. You can find it in your Google. If you Google it, you can find it many of the place. One of the activity during earthquake is liquefaction of the soil. You know, better when the water table is high in any of the area. Suppose any of the area is having water table. In case of Rajasthan, Jodhpur, one of the area is there where the water table is just below 3 to 4 feet below the earth, right? So that area is very vulnerable to the liquefaction during any of the seismic activity, because liquefaction is the densification of the soil. Soil will densify and the water will come up. You know, the foundation on which your building is standing, now the foundation is gone, only water will be there, because your soil will be densified because of the movement of the earth, right? So that densification of the soil is called as liquefaction of the soil. So these are some of the pictures of liquefaction of the soil and lateral spreading. Landsliding will be there. So there are many things which are there because of this earthquake is concerned. I'll quickly go through some of the guidelines, some of the earthquake resistant design building features. And you know, first principle of the designing of earthquake resistant housing is the reduced mass. Reduced mass means as your building will be of lighter weight, you know, less damage will be there. Symmetry and continuity, always think about the symmetric building, and continuity in the buildings will be there, should be there. And another thing is ductility. Ductility means your building is having some of the tolerance capacity to move, right? If your building will be more and more rigid, because if the person is rigid, then you know that for chances of failure is more. So in case of building also, if your building is more rigid, the chances of failure will be more. In case of load bearing structures, your buildings are rigid, okay, you are joining the brick by using the mortar, but those connections are the problem creating areas. Because connection, that mortar of only 1 to 2 mm is having very, very less strength. Very, very less strength. So when the connection will fail, you are in load bearing structure, load is bared by the wall. If the wall will be gone, your building will automatically collapse. Right? So this ductile detailing code is already there. I have already shown you the ductile detailing code. So just plan your building at very early stage, when you are thinking you need to make your building, just think that we will make our building earthquake resistant. Because I'll tell you one of the story over here. My friend is there in nearby area, and he is a doctor, cancer specialist, and he was making his own building. He paid the architect 2 lakhs of rupees for designing his building, right? He was paying so much of money for designing, for making his house very beautiful. But when I have visited his house during the construction, when I asked him that whether you have taken some of the earthquake features, whether you have taken care of the earthquake because you are residing in zone 5, he was so much surprised that why that architect have never told me that we need to put the earthquake features, we need to provide the earthquake provisions in my building. So he was so much surprised that if the architects are not aware of this earthquake resistant features, if the designers are not aware of this earthquake resistant features, that how we make our building earthquake resistant. right? So this is a very big question in our minds. So if you're building, just build on the very firm soil, if you are making your building, just check, it should not be filled up land, because many of the case studies are there. I have already done many of the consultancy project over here, that many of the filled up land was there, and many of the contractor, they made multi-storied building on the filled up land, and after that many cracks appeared because of the soil settlement. So this is the problem. If you are having filled up land, you need to have raft or pile foundation, okay, because this raft and pile foundation is suitable for this filled up land, because you know, you need to check your soil before constructing. Before construction, you need to check your soil, because on the foundation on which your building will stand, if it will not firm, that definitely your structure will collapse even during small earthquakes, right? So this is how you can plan your building. If your building is asymmetric, suppose T shape, L shape, U shape, and this X shape, so you know, moment of inertia will be different as far as this T is concerned, L is concerned. Rather, if you will have some separation joint in case of asymmetric building, this is the separation joint in case of asymmetric building, you need to provide the separation joint so that this building will act differently, this building will act differently. I'll show in the next slide. Suppose this L-shaped building will be there, and this building is connected with each other. When the earthquake force will be in this direction, suppose in this direction, this wall will act as a out of plane. This force will move this wall as a out of plane, but this move will be in plane, in this direction. This wall will be in plane, this wall will be out of plane. This wall will move more as compared to this wall. So this will collapse, the corner of the building will collapse, right? And if you are having the separation joint, then this building will move accordingly, and this building will move accordingly. And if there is no connection between two buildings, these two buildings will be saved during any of the seismic activity, right? So this separation joint is very, very important. This is the another case. You know, we used to, because you know, this is the case, the length to height ratio should not be more than 4, but we are making these kind of buildings. Why we are making these kind of buildings? Because we are having restriction in our floor area construction. We are having restriction that we can construct only 70% or 60% or 50%, 80% of the building into our lands. We need to leave the place for the open area also. So construction, this floor area is restricted. So now, because of this restriction in floor areas, what we used to do, we make the building according to the floor area on the ground floor. After that, we used to increase some of the parts. You know, if somebody is residing above me, so he used to think that if we'll have this balcony 2 feet more, then what will be the problem? So 2 feet here, then another person above that building, if he will feel that I will move 2 feet more, then what will be the problem? So another 2 feet, and above that another 2 feet. You can well imagine, if a lean person will be there and a very heavy person will sit on his shoulder, and we are moving his legs in to and fro direction, then what will be there? What is the situation of this lean fellow? The heavy weight is on his shoulder, and this heavy weight, this heavy weight will cause the problem, because this lean fellow cannot resist that load, right? So this is the great problem. So this is the situation when you will construct the asymmetric building. This you know, separation gap should be there. This separation gap should be there. And you know, avoid large balconies. So here also, this portion is called as soft story. Soft story means this portion is allowed to move, but this is restricted. This is rigid because of the rigid walls which we are using as an infill. And according to CODAL provision, according to calculation, around 70 to 80% forces will be concentrated on these parts only. When 70% of the forces will be applied to here in these joint region, then joint region will fail and the whole building will collapse. So these are the some of the cases which we have seen in case of Bhuj earthquake. These are the gaps: 15 mm gap for load bearing structure, RCC frame structure 20 mm, the steel frame structure 30 mm. These are the CODAL provision which are given in the code, but practically 50 mm is possible. Because, you know, this small gap of 20 mm and 30 mm, 50 mm, I have seen many of the buildings having the separation joint of 50 mm, right? And that separation joint is also depend upon the story of the building, how much story or how much stories you have built in that building. Okay, in case of liquefaction of the soil, you need to have raft foundation and pile foundations. Okay, don't have any of the water tank, any of the swimming pool on the top of your building, because, you know, again, the concept of heavy structure having the liquid in that, when the earthquake will come. What is the difference between earthquake as well as wind force? Wind force will be applied to your building in one direction for many, many hours. Suppose 5 hours, 6 hours, 2 hours, wind will move in one direction. But earthquake force is reversal in seconds. The earthquake force will be reversal in seconds. Suppose it is applied in one direction, another second it will apply in other direction, right? So cyclic kind of a loading will be there during earthquake. But in case of wind, cyclic kind of loading is not there. In case of earthquake, cyclic kind of loading will be there. Load will be applied to the building, removing of the load, then applied of the load in the another direction. So this is the difference between wind force and earthquake force. So here, if you will have water tank on the top of the building will move, the water will move in one direction, at the another second water will try to move in another direction. So you can well imagine that the concentration of the forces, how the concentration of the forces will be there during any of the activity if you are having water tank on the top of your surface. So these are the some of the provisions. You should not have the longer wall more than 5 meters. If you are having the longer walls more than 5 meters, you need to have partition walls or you need to have buttresses. Why we need to have this partition wall and buttresses? Because to reduce the unsupported length of the wall. You know, if the unsupported length of the wall will be more, then the chances of the collapse, when the out of plane action of the wall will be there, when the force will be applied in the out of plane direction, if this unsupported length is more than 5 meter, it will definitely collapse in case of out of plane direction, right? So if you are having stone frame, if you are having stone structure, you need to have through stones. These through stones are, you know, joining one of the whole wall into one part, right? If you are not having that much of big stone, you can have the wooden stone, wooden plank also. If you are not having the wooden plank, you can turn your bar into S shape and just keep this bar here, right? So this will also do work as a through stone. These are the corners, how you can corner will be tied. This is the way you need to tie your column, the corners, so that during any of the activity, this corner will not open up, right? So these are the some of the bands: plinth band, lintel band, and roof band. Your opening should be at least 600 mm away from the corners, right? These are the some of the bands. These are the vertical bands. If you are residing in zone 5, these vertical bands are very, very necessary, right? So this is how you need to provide the bands. These are the horizontal bands. You can have it from steel, from bamboo, but we are recommending as a steel. These bands you need to provide as per Indian standard code, because in Indian standard code it is given that how much band, how much number of bars you need to provide in case of these bands. So you need to provide these bands in at a different level. Why these bands are provided? First, to tie your building together. Another, to reduce the unsupported length of the structure. Unsupported length of the structure should be reduced, so that is why we need to provide this these kind of a bands, right?